Video game adaptations of famous films have a long history. Throughout the 80s, loose versions of beloved sci-fi and action classics flooded the market, and today, licensed tie-ins are almost obligatory. Over time, no movie franchise has made a bigger impact on gaming than Star Wars, which boasts well over 100 separate releases for practically every system that has ever existed. Star Wars titles go so far back that they actually predate what many modern gamers would even recognise as a game. The first official product took the form of a small tabletop unit, Star Wars Electronic Battle Command, and used simple lights and sound to simulate space exploration. Though Electronic Battle Command was impressive in its day, adaptations of the much-loved original trilogy, and its later sequels, have grown in sophistication with each passing year. As I record this, Star Wars Squadrons has only recently released, complete with VR capability, developed by Motive Studios, and published, of course, by Electronic Arts. But before EA took over the series, it was helmed by LucasArts, the same beloved developers behind a string of classic point-and-click adventures, like Monkey Island. Since LucasArts was founded in 1982 by George Lucas himself, its connection to Star Wars runs deep. Therefore, their releases have always been celebrated as authentic and rich expansions on established lore, through loving storylines, varied gameplay, and naturally, incredible audio. I'm Lee Tyrrell, and this is The Sound Test, where I look in depth at video game audio and music, along with the very people who crafted it. Contacting every musician involved with Star Wars titles over the years would have been practically impossible, but I am joined for this special by three of the most influential. To help explore the franchise's early days, I spoke to Paul Webb.
Are you hearing me okay?
Best known for his work on Super Star Wars. From there, you can't discuss the further growth of LucasArts through the 90s and on into the noughties without Clint Bajakian.
Hi.
And Peter McConnell.
Hey Lee.
Who both also composed for Indiana Jones. Between the four of us, we'll cover the sound of Star Wars adaptations from the Nintendo Entertainment System up to the PlayStation 1 and PCs, when CD audio took over from chiptune. Indeed, the stirring orchestral scores of John Williams, featured in the original films, are the polar opposite of early home console music. In the late 80s and early 90s, most systems were only capable of extremely simple synthesized waveforms, commonly referred to as bleeps and bloops. The common limit of four or so channels in retro game soundtracks is completely different to a fully stocked orchestra too. So how did those famous themes translate to something like the NES? Paul Webb actually worked on an adaptation of Empire Strikes Back for the console, developed in conjunction with Sculptured Software.
Through the vast majority of my career in video gaming, I was working for a company called Sculptured Software. And I mean, that's where I started. I mean, I started back with Sculptured Software back in the days when they were doing games for the PC before PCs had sound cards. So I tell people I was composing for the solo whoopee cushion. I don't know if you've ever heard old PC gaming music before anybody had a sound card, but it was just using the PC speaker. IBM compatibles, but yeah, that was, you know, way back before the digital audio revolution, back before PCs, you know, really had any kind of professional sound cards, at least normally. So it was really way back in the early days. And then just sculpture software evolved and developed and got to the point where it started doing, more high-end games and, got in obviously into NES and then later into Super NES. And I actually did an NES version of Empire Strikes Back before we did the Super Star Wars. I'm not sure how it actually happened that we did this, but the company that I worked for, Sculptured Software, didn't do NES Star Wars, but then we ended up doing NES Empire Strikes Back. And so, of course, the NES chip is very simple, very limited, so I did what I could, and I discovered that most of the music that I've done for video games is up on YouTube now, and apparently people use it for easy listening. I don't know. I still find it kind of surprising how much the interest there is in this old stuff. But I did find my Empire Strikes Back NES music on YouTube and said, oh yeah, well, for NES, I guess I didn't do too bad a job. Sculpture Software was a contractor and contracted with LucasArts to do the NES Empire Strikes Back, and to help me transcribe the music into NES, they sent me the score. And the score they sent me wasn't like a commercially printed score, it was like a manuscript score. And I'm pretty sure it was literally the actual score that John Williams used when he conducted the music, because it had his notes on it. I can't imagine what it would go for on eBay at this point. Well, I'd probably get arrested if I tried to sell it on eBay now, so. But, so that was pretty fun. I mean, I'm a huge fan of John Williams. I'm a huge fan of the Star Wars score, so. That was like a huge thrill to me, and to be able to work with this in the video game realm was just really fun for me. So that was my first introduction to Star Wars music for video games, was the NES Empire. And then it was maybe a year or two later that we did Super Star Wars.
The Super Nintendo, which Super Star Wars released for, is a completely different beast to the NES that preceded it. In my upcoming console specials, you'll hear a lot more focused insight on the technical details behind both of them, with Paul included as a guest. But for now, it's enough to say that the SNES boasted double the channels of what came before, and the ability to play compressed sample sounds. That meant Paul could compose with much more realistic textures. Instead of bleeps and bloops, listeners can clearly identify different string and brass instruments within Super Star Wars and its two sequels. However, when compared to a full orchestra, the Super Nintendo was still vastly handicapped.
I had 8 channels, which from, you know, from the history of what we could do in the past, that was a lot. But from what we needed to do for symphony music, that wasn't much. Because you don't have 8 symphony instruments, you have a whole huge range of symphonic instruments. And then, you know, you have different sections, like we have, you know, violins, violas, cellos, and basses, and the violins might be split into first, second violins, and you know, you'd have trombones and bass trombones and so forth and so on, and so many different instruments. So what I had to do is take John Williams' score and take any section of that score and say, okay, what's the most important things going on here? What's the primary thing? When I listen to it, what hits my ear first? Okay, in this section, it's the strings. It's the violin section that hits me first. And the next thing that hits me in the same section is, say, the trumpets. And then the next thing that hits me is the low bass instruments, the double bass and the trombones playing together or something like that. And so I just figure out this, you know, these eight things are what make it sound the most like the orchestration at that moment in the score. So I'll just basically trim the score down to just those eight parts and, make sure that reasonably sounds like what the score actually originally sounded like. And so that was the process of just basically recreating John Williams' score within these super narrow limits of a tiny amount of RAM and only eight possible different parts at the same time. And so that's what I ultimately did to get it to work and make it sound, you know, more or less like John Williams' score. And I listen to it now and go, ew, boy, I guess that sounds like the score, but oh, it doesn't sound very good by today's standards. But by the standards of that time, people were pretty impressed with how it sounded. People that didn't have a good ear for high-end, high-quality music and didn't really have a sense of what great sound quality was versus just really cheap sound quality. Some people that I talked to actually thought that I'd taken the digital score, you know, the digital recording, and used it directly and streamed it, which of course was absolutely impossible on the Super Nintendo. But that sounded enough like Star Wars score to them that they thought I'd actually just used the actual recording. But of course, I had to recreate it literally from the ground up.
Around the same time as Super Star Wars, Peter McConnell and Clint Bajakian worked on music for Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis, another video game adaptation of a famous film series with John Williams themes. Along with Michael Land, they formed a legendary trio who shared duties on a number of LucasArts classics. Instead of home consoles, Fate of Atlantis was released for personal computers, which generally have stronger audio hardware. As such, it was eventually developed as a talkie, an old colloquial term for games that feature fully fledged voice acting. In 1993, talkies were still a novelty on PCs and practically impossible for consoles like the SNES. LucasArts had a reputation for such innovation through the 90s, helped in part by designers like Hal Barwood, who brought some real Hollywood pedigree to the team. Barwood's professional association with George Lucas himself goes back as far as THX-1138, Lucas's debut theatrical film. Working side by side with such talent is bound to be enriching, and both Peter and Clint rubbed shoulders with Hal Barwood through Fate of Atlantis. So, despite being predominantly musicians, what did they learn from their experiences with a well-known movie producer?
Really, pretty much everything about visual storytelling. And Hal was a movie director before he was a game designer. He went to school with George Lucas and Steven Spielberg. He was personal friends with them. He was in the room when with Steven Spielberg and John Williams when Steven was talking about what are we going to do for you know, our main theme. We got to have a main theme for Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and what's something that sounds elemental, you know, and you know, and then John taps out, you know, bum 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 bum. Hal had made at least 5 feature films himself, one called Corvette Summer, another one which is probably a little, probably his best known film was Dragon Slayer, which is a really, really cool film if you've seen it. He just knew everything there was to know, especially about movies. He actually had this thing, I still have it, called, something was called Filmmaking 101, and he would analyze, say, the scene where Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz is first confronted by Elphaba, and compare that to the scene in Get Shorty where Tony, I can't remember the character's name anyway, he would compare these two scenes, and there are all these things about how the character was framed, who was above whom, how the camera moved, all this stuff that was just like, oh, that's how that works, you know? That's why that's so iconic. These days he's kind of in retirement, and he writes suspense novels now. He's just a super interesting guy and a super knowledgeable guy, and he just taught me and taught us how visual storytelling works with it, and also how music works with the visual storytelling. So in Indie 4, you know, which was the first chance I really got to work with Hal, it was like going to school, you know. It's like, well, here's how, you know, the music can either anticipate something or it can react to it. You know, that was you know, what a simple thing, but you don't necessarily articulate that in your mind until you really think about it a lot. And we talk about, you know, when we score a cutscene, well, is what's the music doing here? Is it creating a mood, or is it reacting to a situation? So that's just, you know, one example. And a lot of the stuff that I learned was about the storytelling and the you know, how to do a shot. I'll give you an example of a Hal example. This is how you do visual storytelling, right? This is from, you know, some noir from the 40s, right? So you gotta picture the cultural milieu of the 40s. Man walks into elevator with wife. You know they are married. I don't know how you know this, but you know they're married. He's wearing his hat. They turn around, face the doors, and the doors close. Doors open on next floor. Attractive woman walks into elevator. Man takes off hat. Now, this little sequence of events takes really a few seconds, but from that few seconds, you realize very deeply that the man and his wife are having problems. That's what Hal brought to the table, was this just incredible, rich understanding of everything that you do to tell a story and entertain someone visually. And from that, you learn about a lot about how the music works and the sound works as well.
Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis had extremely high production values, but audio was still limited by the hardware of the time. Because the popularization of high-quality digital audio was still a couple of years away, Clint and Peter were forced to work with MIDI, a system for composing with digital instrumentation. Again inspired by John Williams, the game has an orchestral sound, which takes some care to get right with MIDI. The soaring, dynamic themes from Indiana Jones make for particularly ambitious adaptations, made worse by the fact that some players had outputs as simple as a single-channel internal speaker.
We were writing generally in an orchestral idiom, but you are absolutely correct that the capacity of the software systems and the hardware, acutely RAM was extremely limited. I would bring an arrangement, a MIDI file to the team, and I remember it was Mike Stemley, who you may have heard of, and he's one of a really great developer at LucasArts. He turned to me, he said, "You know, Clint, this MIDI file is too big. We only have 38K available for the music at this point in the game." 38K. So I went back and was thinning the drum data and even had to cut a section of the composition out simply because the MIDI note data and controller data swelled the file up to a whopping 47K or something, and you know, I had to trim 9K out of it. So it really was something. So here you are writing in an orchestral idiom, but you've got those sorts of limitations. So I think ultimately it really helped us as composers in a way, and probably a way that you already can imagine. We had to figure out at any given moment, what were the really salient musical elements? What were the parts, the melodies, the counter melody that were the most critical to communicate the musical intent of a piece? And that's what we did, and it was really pretty rigorous. So yes, we had a great deal of challenge in that area. Both in terms of the size of our files and in terms of audio, we had to, you know, knock the sample rate down and the bit rate down and go to compressed audio formats. And in the case of even MIDI, we had to watch our file sizes, and we had to compose, as you say, for a much smaller number of voices to try to, and yet still try to simulate or emulate the sound of an orchestra.
You could spend months or a year or even longer doing a really, incredibly detailed large oil painting of someone, or you can actually do just a 10-second charcoal sketch of a figure, and that 10-second sketch can get across the feeling of what that person is doing, you know, with just 10 seconds and charcoal and sheet paper. And so when we were trying to do these reductions of orchestral scores, the idea was to find the essence, to go through all the parts and see which ones are the important ones. It's obviously more painstaking process than actually in terms of work, it's almost like doing the oil painting. But in terms of result, it's more like the gesture drawing, where you're just showing what you're able to show with the resources and time that you have, which is you're showing the feeling of the piece.
Aside from trimming existing compositions for limited channels, Peter and Clint also faced another challenge. For both Indiana Jones and Star Wars games, there were many occasions where they were tasked with composing their own music, but often in the style of John Williams. Even then, there were so many titles based on Star Wars that simply regurgitating the themes wasn't enough. As the library of adaptations grew, the audio team needed more to play with.
Well, especially when some of the earlier stuff like X-Wing and TIE Fighter, where we were actually composing out notes. when it's yourself, it is a different process, because instead of doing a rendition of something which is big on something which is small, what you're doing is you are embracing the concept of, I am writing a piece for a small thing, and I'm going to leverage everything that small thing is good at, that sound card is good at, to make my music, and I'm not going to make it pretend to be something that it's not. Partly because of the limitations of the card, we had a certain amount of freedom to kind of be ourselves and just refer to John Williams themes, because it had to sound good on that card. So it was more like doing, and you know, I do this all the time still, more like doing your version of a well-known thing. It's like a theme of in variations, if you will, or an arrangement or a cover. All those things have something that is established that you're not going to mess with, but beyond the basic thing that's established, which is usually just a theme melody, you have tremendous leeway to do whatever you want and express yourself.
The original Star Wars trilogy is well known for its technical innovations and spectacular production quality. Thanks to professionals like Peter and Clint, the games that those films inspired are just as impressive. For example, 1993's Rebel Assault achieved state-of-the-art graphics and sound due to its release on the CD-ROM format. It was LucasArts' first CD-ROM-only game, which opened many doors for the creative team. Streaming data directly from disk allowed for outstanding cutscenes, as well as some clever additions to gameplay and sound design, implemented largely by director Vince Lee.
He was just, I think, a genius, and he experimented with streaming and with, you know, a method of getting data. And I'm a layperson when it comes to this, so I'm kind of out of my depth here. But getting data off of the disk using what's called a buffer in memory, which essentially you're filling the front end of the buffer at whatever rate you can, basically, you know, getting that data off the disk, and there are bandwidth issues with that back, especially in those days. There still are, but bandwidth is always an issue, you know, internet speed and you know, what format of video can we stream, you know, over a given internet connection, and so bandwidth will probably always be an issue and a perceived limitation in every age. But back then, it really was severely limited, you would use this buffer in memory to fill from the disk, and then on the back end of the buffer, you would then pay out that data at a fixed rate to whatever decoder or decode process. I'm kind of forgetting some of the technical aspects of it. But he experimented with it and realized that, and I think another one of his innovations was the format of the video compression. Being both, which is always the goal in any compression, which is trying to be as efficient as possible and get the data size as small as possible, and yet maintaining as high a possible quality of image quality and graphic quality. So those are always the trade-offs, and the Holy Grail is trying to find, you know, to optimize in both those directions. He came up with something that was viable, and it was even viable for a professional product release. And so management was overjoyed, and he really, you know, literally was his one-man R&D, research and development. He worked, you know, at his desk and just developed this technology of streaming video, interleaved with audio, and he even built the authoring tools to do this. And the way that Rebel Assault worked was really interesting. The backgrounds were streamed video, and they were effectively, to use a phrase that we sometimes use, they were effectively canned. And what I mean by canned is they were predetermined linear pieces of video content. Even though you were in an interactive context, like a video game, think of the backgrounds in Rebel Assault as being kind of like an amusement park ride, where it's the same every time. But the 3D models, I believe they were 3D. Maybe they weren't. Maybe they were 2D. I can't remember. But the models, the ship models, and the, you know, the laser guns and the proton torpedoes and the projectiles that would come out of those models were dynamic, and they were effectively loaded into RAM and controlled dynamically by the player against a fixed video background. So that's how it worked, and he had the ability to, and I'm trying to remember the name of the tool, but it was a really cool tool that gave you a number of channels. I can't remember the maximum number of audio, mono audio channels it gave. I think it might have been 4 or 8. Might have been, I can't remember. But these were not the sound effects, like the lasers and things, which needed to just be loaded into RAM and fired off by the game when needed. But these were the streamed audio that were meant to be like background music, background sound. And I'm wondering if, yeah, when in certain situations like cutscenes and cinematics, the dialogue would get put on the timeline against the video. So effectively, he built a tool that was very similar to the standard high-end tools that we use in video production, like Final Cut Pro or Pro Tools, where you have audio tracks and the ability to import a video and work, edit your audio in a multi-track format against that video. He, you know, it was extremely primitive compared to those tools, but it worked.
Vince Lee, who designed Rebel Assault, began his association with LucasArts in 1990. For around a decade to follow, his work with video compression was invaluable, notably through impressive software like Insane. Therefore, his name often features in the credits of LucasArts classics from the time, such as Monkey Island, Sam and Max, Grim Fandango, and many more. It wasn't unusual for him to heavily impact other departments, such as sound, where his colleagues usually kept a refreshingly open mind.
Vince took the main Star Wars theme for his early prototypes of that game engine, and he took the headphone out of his boombox and put the other end into his Sound Blaster card and fired up some really simple little application to record it, to dub it from his boombox over a headphone cable directly into a sound card so that he could have it as a digital audio file. Well, because it was a headphone output, it totally overdrove the input of the sound card, and the resulting sound file was massively saturated and distorted. We said, oh boy, this is great, Vince. It's amazing what you're doing. I'll tell you what though, let me take the CD to my studio and do a proper dub, you know, that follows all the rules of audio and audio production and doesn't clip and doesn't distort and all that. And I worked so hard with EQs and everything else to try to get the result as big and warm and impressive as his, and I couldn't do it. What he had ended up dubbing was the biggest, most impressive sounding rendition of the Star Wars main theme that we came up with, because he was breaking all the rules, because he was oversaturating it and distorting it in a completely, quote, improper way. It was a very interesting story and a really interesting learning experience that showed that you know, there's correct, but then there's also visceral and entertaining and impressive. And so we, at that early date in LucasArts, we started to really begin to understand some of those concepts of sometimes the best thing to do isn't necessarily the correct thing to do. It's something that somehow breaks the rules and achieves something even more grand as a result.
When CD-ROMs took over, audio professionals behind Star Wars games saw a shift in focus. Before then, like with Super Star Wars, the job largely required creative arrangements of famous themes for limited sound chips. Once Redbook Audio and other high-quality encoding formats became standard, so too did using the original orchestral recordings from the films themselves. Peter McConnell, though known for his own compositions, found editing pre-existing music to be just as rewarding and an interesting challenge in its own right.
When we could do digital audio with the Star Wars stuff, we just wanted to edit Johnny because that's what's, you know, John Williams, because that's what was appropriate and sounded good and had the most impact and was the real deal, so to speak. When digital audio came in and we were just working with the actual cues, for me, what it became was it's not really a compositional act, but it is compositional training, because you have to find pieces that you only have something like 3 hours of music in all of the Star Wars canon. It's pathetically small. I mean, I'm talking about the original three movies, which is mostly what I worked on, because the only episode one was the last thing that I worked on. But the original movies, you only have like 3 hours of music, but you've got, 40 hours of game experience and all these titles that you keep doing. So how are you going to make that fresh? How are you going to make those few pieces, you know, work with each other in different ways? That becomes the challenge. And also just the mechanics of finding a place in the music that's going to fit with another piece and transition to it smoothly, say for a cutscene. It's tremendously good ear experience, because you're listening to how all the instruments are interlocking and what themes are going on, and you're going to find some way to make that continue in the next piece, even though it's a completely different cut.
While the original orchestral recordings became prevalent in Star Wars games, as soon as technically possible, it didn't put an end to creativity. Some titles cleverly mixed well-known themes, while others broke them down to smaller pieces for use in a dynamic system. Composers like Clint and Peter were no strangers to their own additions and experiments too, reflecting some of the frustration that can come with so much editing work.
That process of just editing John Williams, it got a little, you know, it got a little old, to be honest with you, because you can only do that so many times. And also for the titles, it became a, you know, you don't want to wear out the audience. So we did come up with some, innovative ways of handling that. And one of the things that comes to mind is Force Commander, where we actually did sort of house mixes of John Williams music, These were met with, it's funny because, you know, when you're dealing with something like Star Wars or Indiana Jones, you're dealing with a very dedicated, especially Star Wars, you're dealing with a very dedicated and opinionated fan base. And if you mess with their world, they can, you know, exact pretty severe revenge. I got some fan, we got some fan for Force Commander. We did something that I'd always wanted to do, which was to put the Imperial March music over a heavy metal beat. And I brought in my Marshall half stack, and we recorded this part, this heavy metal guitar part, and a heavy big fat drum machine. It was going with a big fat drum machine, and then had the actual orchestra as kind of a found object above that. And you know, while we were recording, two floors up from us, people were telling people to turn it down. I mean, it's good, you know, it's a Marshall half stack, and if you're familiar with those, they're pretty loud. it was sort of a great bit of prankish fun to do. But the fans, and I also might add, Mr. Williams' agent didn't particularly appreciate it. And I got one piece of hate mail, which was, whoever did this should be demoted to the mailroom, which was an insult to the mailroom, actually. I mean, it was a great amount of distaste that was some of the more like trance hip hop crowd were like, wow, this is dope, man, this is awesome. And I did get actually called up to the ranch about, and kind of, you know, let's not do this again. Yeah, basically the second in command of the whole empire. But, I'm glad that we were able to, you know, take some risks. And, you know, the whole thing about risks is, if they don't screw up sometimes, then they aren't really risks. So, yeah.
By the 21st century, such experimentation was possible across the board. With the exception of handheld systems, pretty much all home computers and consoles were able to play back high-quality sound. As discussed, that opened the door for authentic John Williams recordings, while offering new opportunities for native VGM composers. For 2003's Indiana Jones and the Emperor's Tomb, Clint got the chance to work directly with an orchestra himself.
Indiana Jones and the Emperor's Tomb was my first project working with live orchestra. And interestingly, I had left LucasArts just a couple years before and happily was hired by Jeff Clement and the LucasArts sound team to be the composer on that product. And that was extremely gratifying and exciting. And of course, exciting to work in the style of John Williams and try to create a score that felt like an Indiana Jones score. Very, very exciting, very challenging. Many people agree, I believe, John Williams possesses the greatest level of control over the forces of the orchestra. He deeply understands the orchestra and the infinite nuances that it's capable of. So to be called upon to work in that genre or style is extremely challenging and also very exciting. The the thing that I did as a business person, running my own company at that time called Bay Area Sound, with my partner Julian Kwasniewski, there was no budget for live orchestra. And all there was budget for was my creative fee and sitting, you know, and producing the whole score using samples in my studio. But I made the business decision and the sort of career development decision to utilize my creative fee, or a vast majority of it, to hire an orchestra. And that orchestra was the Northwest Sinfonia up in Seattle. A really wonderful orchestra, and they're widely used. And one of the things that they offer is a complete buyout of the recordings, in comparison with unions, where there's typically rights packages that are attached to the recordings. So I booked with them. I had learned from Darren Stinnett, and I surrounded myself with talented people. I hired a wonderful orchestrator, Steve Zuckerman. I went with a wonderful orchestral contractor who would pull all the musicians together. I hired a seasoned conductor up in Seattle, and a seasoned recording company to come to Bastyr Chapel, which is a deconsecrated Catholic beautiful chapel church. And it's known for being quite resonant and reverberant, so the orchestral recordings tend to be very lush and big there. So I had everything going for me because I really couldn't go wrong with such talent helping me.
While it's true that full orchestral recordings could be included in games by the 21st century, the main stumbling block was budgeting. Most of the time, developers simply didn't have the money to hire such an ensemble, which is precisely why Clint had to reach into his own pocket. Over 15 years on from Indiana Jones and the Emperor's Tomb, orchestras are far more common, largely thanks to the industry's ever-increasing respect for game audio. Back then, composers had to make do with their own resources, and live players were expensive. So MIDI, Clint's old friend throughout the 90s, was used to fill the gaps. In those circumstances, how do you decide what would work best synthesized? And what requires the full heft of an orchestra?
What I determined, which I think was an interesting and I do believe correct assessment, was that it's the action music with, you know, characteristically more notes, more note events, more fast runs and scales and essentially repeated attacks of different notes and many notes throughout the different orchestral groups, meaning all the more opportunities to hear that the music is fake, that it's being produced by samples and machines, not by real people playing real instruments. So slower music, you'll have longer notes, fewer notes in the arrangement typically, it's more atmospheric, and you know, so these sample libraries are effectively the recording of a real instrumentalist playing their instrument, but it's the attack that, especially back then, it's gotten much better today, which I won't go into, other than to say that when you play repeated notes in today's high-end libraries, it's a different attack each time, just like real life. But back then, it was often the same attack. So when you played repeated notes or a fast scale, it sounded a little bit like a light switch being turned on and off. It's just very mechanical. So the slower music with fewer attacks and longer held notes and smaller, thinner arrangements played very well in the sampled world. And the action pieces really, of course, did well with a live orchestra. So that's how I divided it up. Unfortunately, we didn't do much lush, slow, atmospheric music with the live orchestra, which would have been beautiful, but we did get all the action music and some of the principal themes for the game with live orchestra. And, they were wonderful. I think I recorded them for 8 hours, 4 hours, and then lunch, and then 4 hours. I know that the score came out successfully. It won the Game Audio Network Guild Music of the Year Award and a few other awards that year. So it was a very worthwhile thing to have done. You know, it was unfortunate not collecting my creative fee, but probably a wise use of it.
When adapting huge franchises like Indiana Jones into the world of video games, the development teams were clearly driven to do things properly. Generally, their efforts were incredibly well received, and LucasArts built a reputation for faithful and loving expansions on classic movies. A lot of that reputation came down to how well sound was implemented. Whether it's through Paul Webb's stunning John Williams chiptune, or Clint's attention to detail. The 1999 PlayStation and PC adaptation of The Phantom Menace, a vastly underrated release, is a prime example of his work outside of composition. In that instance, he was even able to collaborate with Ben Burtt, renowned for his contributions to the audio of Star Wars, Indiana Jones, E.T., Star Trek, and many, many more. To name just a few of his achievements, he's the one who popularized the Wilhelm scream, designed the lightsaber horn, and amazingly, voiced Wall-E. Ta-da!
Yes, that was a great pleasure. We had met Ben and just sort of had small talk with him from time to time up at the ranch when there were events up there and things. But when it came to The Phantom Menace, our mandate was to simultaneously release a game for the PlayStation with the release of the film, which obviously creates all kinds of challenges, especially in regard to any art or audio assets that the game team needed to borrow from the film team. So it set up a kind of a need to collaborate during the production of both the game and the movie. So it was a wonderful arrangement. I'm not sure it was all that convenient for Ben. Because after all, he had his hands full working on this film, and now he had the added logistical layer of making sure that he and his assistants, provided us with freshly approved assets that he had created. So it was really exciting for me to be, taking receipt of these wonderful, incredible sound effects before anybody in the world had heard them, and then working with the game development team to get them, properly formatted and into the game. Of course, I had to do a lot of original sound design as well in the same sort of style to cover ground. But it was a really exciting thing to work in tandem with the film, and it was a way to get to know Ben better, and he's just the nicest guy in the world.
Clint's influence on the audio of Star Wars games goes well beyond music and sound. The Phantom Menace is just one of many games that features his talents as a voice actor. For that game, Clint voiced Jabba the Hutt, but he's also played Darth Vader, Darth Maul, droids, and a variety of NPCs. He's not the only LucasArts musician to step behind the microphone either, and for a while at least, the company seemed determined to cast their games with in-house employees and close associates.
I was fortunate that the voiceover director, Tamlin Barra, brought me in enough, and we were pretty much exclusively a union house, meaning that we worked with SAG-AFTRA union. When you work with the union, you have to work with the union across the board or you're violating the rules. So she asked if I wouldn't mind joining the union, and so that they could continue to use me for Jabba the Hutt or Darth Vader, and in conformity with the rules of the union. And I was pleased to do that and amazed at the amount of pay that a simple one-hour session or three-hour session would bring in. It was a tremendous ancillary revenue stream, actually, and just a lot of fun to do.
Before CD-ROMs and similar formats made voiceovers in games widespread, only the most rudimentary examples were possible. Due to the technical limitations of the Super Nintendo, voices were treated more like sound effects, if any were used at all. SNES cartridges just didn't have the memory capacity for spoken dialogue, outside of a few grunts or one-off lines. However, Paul Webb still managed to incorporate a couple of genuine samples into the Super Star Wars series, despite the extra efforts it took to include them.
Well, especially at that time in history, it was super hard to construct something, synthesize a voice. Nowadays, you can do a lot more voice synthesis. It's a lot easier to do, or, you know, it's more widely done and more widely understood. But back then, you know, that wasn't really an option for me. So, and there wasn't too much of any actual vocal stuff in Super Star Wars. When they were in the transport music, or in the transport section of the game where they were, where you had that big old the ground transporter that was just prowling around the planet and picking up junk and selling it, and in the game you had to jump along and try to get through it and get up to the top of it and so forth. So when I was doing that, you actually had to kill the poor little things, and when you did, you got that little wootoonie sound. I think the only other actual recording of somebody saying anything that I put into the game was I took a little tiny section towards the end of Star Wars where Luke is trying to destroy the Death Star, and Obi-Wan says, you know, from the, you know, the other realm, Obi-Wan says, "Luke, use the Force.
Use the Force, Luke."
So I was actually able to take that, and there was, of course, music in there. I didn't have the little pieces. They didn't give me, like, the original tracks all separated. So I had to take the actual recording from the movie where it has the music and the actor saying that phrase, and I stuck it in there, and I worked around my music so that it kind of dovetailed with the actual music of this little short digital recording, so you could actually hear Obi-Wan Kenobi saying, "Luke, use the Force." So, and that was about the, I think they were probably the only two things. I may be forgetting something, but they may have been the only two things where I actually had a recorded voice doing anything. Usually it was just a matter of lowering the sample rate as far as I could get away with till it was, you know, a size that might actually fit.
As Paul worked on Super Star Wars, LucasArts weren't far off cracking spoken dialogue for their PC games. The first PlayStation and the N64 made voice acting more important to the home console scene. But PC players, as usual, had a head start. Companies like LucasArts were important to the development of what were colloquially known as talkies, right at the start of the 90s. The aforementioned Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis was actually re-released as a talkie a year after its initial release. Like Clint, Peter McConnell took a big hand in all things audio for LucasArts in that prolific period, gladly dipping his toe into voiceover work himself.
When we were just first starting, and this is, I'm talking about like 91 or so, and this big watershed event happened, which was the Sound Blaster came out, and Vince Lee, this is starting in 92 or 93, that Vince Lee did Rebel Assault. But it became, as soon as the Sound Blaster came out, everybody was talking about, well, we're going to do talkies, they called them. And there was a whole thing about, well, some of us in the music department, I was one of them, but I have a real history, by the way, of not being much of a visionary when it comes to the future. I was like, well, I think if we add voice to this, it's going to ruin the magic of the rest of the sound, and nothing could be more wrong, really. It's just another tool to work with. But in that era, right, half the games out there were still made by a couple of guys in a garage, right? And these guys might be think erroneously that not only could they program, and I say guys, they probably were guys. they think erroneously that not only could they program, but they could also voice act and write music as well. So you had some really, really just god-awful stuff out there of just true. Some of the voice acting from that period is like it makes Mystery Science Theater look like Ingmar Bergman. There is some really disastrous stuff, and since we were LucasArts, we really tried to uphold pretty early on a high standard. Now that said, with things like Rebel Assault 2, I think that's where I did Yoda. It was kind of like, well, I was the front around who could do it the best, so we did it. And later on, the Admiral Akbar character, they couldn't get him for some reason, and I was tapped to do that as well. For a long time, Clint did all the Darth Vaders. And then we had found someone with a better set of pipes who could really do it. But anyway, as soon as this started happening, essentially a voice department was created. And there was a certain amount of overlap between the voice department and the music department. And so we would get involved with Darth because we felt that it was essentially doing James Earl Jones right was the equivalent of recording an opera singer. The voice department folks were, not all that happy about that, but they were, we worked it out. As things grew and got bigger and bigger and the actors became more and more, high profile, the number of times that the music folks would get involved in voice got less and less, appropriately so. It got sort of, I think the only, after doing Akbar a few times, mostly what I did was die. you know, nothing in Sector M. I died a bunch, but I personally like to do, you know, voice acting. I'm not an actor. I'm not a professional, but it's something I have an interest in, and so I've done it a little bit. But and Clint is, who has a really wonderful set of pipes, meaning the quality of his voice. He did quite a few voices as well. He can probably tell you about that. But these were the us doing that stuff. It was really kind of a hangover, honestly, from that era when the couple folks in the garage could, you know, would try to do everything. And I'm glad it's not that way anymore.
Peter, Clint, Paul, and the many others who produced sound for Star Wars games, and continue to do so, have always held authenticity in high esteem. Truth be told, and I'm willing to admit it as we close this episode, I've never been the biggest fan of Star Wars movies. Yet, even I have been easily persuaded by the strength of their video game adaptations, and have played many of them extensively across my lifetime. That says a lot about the blood, sweat, and tears that went into them, and how important it was to LucasArts that they capture the spirit and grandeur of those films, and enhance them with great gameplay. Audio is an integral part of those experiences, dancing beneath every scenario and tapping along with every step you take. Peter, Clint, and Paul's reverence for what came before them, and their talents for finding new ways to apply those themes, takes you directly to a galaxy far, far away, and allows you to express yourself within it.
It's a great musical education to go through that process, to reduce something that's as complex as a piece of John Williams music into an eight voice synthesizer piece. Now, you know, it's definitely an imperfect result, but it's a lot of fun to do. And hopefully if you do it right, people will be reminded of what it's supposed to be, if that makes sense.
Every month, I think it was every month, they put out the magazine, and one game would be featured on the cover of the magazine. And when that game was featured, they would send a plaque to the game developer, you know, as kind of a recognition of this being a prominent game. And the plaque would normally have engraved on it the name of the lead programmer. And they told me that for the first time for Super Star Wars, they also put the name of the audio guys, me and Mark Gainis, on that plaque. So that was kind of a new honor that I guess wasn't bestowed in the past. So that was kind of fun.
Star Wars came out, and we were all impressed with Darth Vader, and I was 15 years old. And I started imitating him, and I have kind of a deep voice to begin with. Give yourself to the dark side. I would put a wastebasket over my head or an ice bucket or something that would make it resonate. And little did I know that there were acoustical reasons why that actually moved it closer to the sound. And as a quick digression, Ben Bird explained it to me once. It was about 11 milliseconds of delay that they would put on the voice and then turn up the feedback of that delay. And what'll happen is it starts to beat. It starts to beat against itself and become, if you turn up the feedback too much, it'll get out of control and it'll start ripping and it'll be this continuous, like loud, vicious buzzer-like sound. So that's if you turn up the feedback too much. But if you just add a little feedback with a short delay, it gives it a ringing, buzzy quality. And that's one of the ways in which they treated James Earl Jones's voice. So little did I know that just being a kid with a wastebasket on my head, that I would actually years later be paid, unbelievably, to act as Darth Vader in our video games.
Thanks to Clint, Peter, and Paul for speaking to me for the sound test. But thank you too for taking the time to listen. If you've enjoyed what you've heard, please make sure to follow or subscribe on whatever platform you may be listening on. There are still many episodes to come in this second series, and the first season is freely available through most popular podcast providers. In the next edition, you'll hear all about the evolution of LucasArts' history as a company, and the various audio professionals who took prominent roles throughout the years. As such, I'm pleased to announce George the Fat Man Sanger, discussing his work for famous titles like Maniac Mansion and Loom. Expect to hear details about how certain key games came about, and some of the historic decisions musicians made when scoring them. After that, the third part will concentrate more on technical information and how systems changed across the lifetime of LucasArts. If you'd like to hear my interviews early, ahead of public release, head on over to patreon.com/_secretcave. There, you can pledge your support for as little as a single pound or dollar to unlock unedited conversations, full quality WAV files, a backlog of otherwise unavailable live shows, and more. Either way, I hope you enjoyed this edition of ST2, and don't forget to join me every Friday, 7 p.m. UK time, for a live and interactive show of VGM Celebration.